Hi, it's Steve Hargadon, and welcome to Library 2.020, Wholehearted Library, Soft Skills for 21st Century Information Professionals. This is the opening keynote. Special thanks to the founding partner of the conference, San Jose State University School of Information. And here to welcome us is Dr. Sandra Hirsch.
Hi, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the Library 2020 conference. As Steve said, I am Dr. Sandy Hirsch. I'm the director of the School of Information at San Jose State University. And San Jose State University, as School of Information, is really delighted to sponsor today's mini conference on Wholehearted Libraries. And we're thrilled to be having this very deep focus, take this time to focus on soft skills for today's information professionals. As we told you in the write-up for the conference, that we're going to be today focusing on defining what soft skills are. We'll be trying to understand how and when to use soft skills, and we'll be hearing some stories and learn additional tips that will help us apply what we're learning today into our workplaces. I want to especially thank Dr. Michael Stevens, who is an associate professor at San Jose State University School of Information, for his help and partnership in organizing today's excellent conference. And I'm sure that you will all find today's conference engaging and valuable. I'm really excited to hear from our keynote panelists, as well as all the people who contributed proposals to the conference, as well as our closing keynote speaker. And so with that, I'd like to turn this over to Dr. Michael Stevens so he can introduce our keynote panel. And welcome again, everyone.
Sandy, thank you. Thank you so much. I am just thrilled to be here. What I think we will do is, as each person speaks, I will tell you a little bit about them. I am honored to have these fine folks with us, Loida, Christian, and Rivkah. We have some really cool stuff to talk about. Let's go ahead one slide here. Folks, watching along with us here today, you are encouraged to please use hashtag Library2020 and hashtag WholeheartedLibraries for tweets, etc. I'm going to give you some things in a bit too, so a little bit of homework for the next 3 hours that we have together with the various sessions as well, that we will use those hashtags as well. So hello, I'm Michael Stevens. I am coming to you from Northern Michigan in the United States. This is Buddy. He's not right back there, but he's in the picture. You may see him walk back and forth. Just wanted to let you know who he was. As I said, I live in Northern Michigan. Out of many things I enjoy doing, I enjoy forest bathing. So let's dive right in. One of the best things we can do as we serve our public, our constituents, our users, whatever you want to call them, is to take care of ourselves. And we're going to come around to that in many different ways. Forest bathing is getting out into the woods and breathing and relaxing and sort of resetting your brain. Right now, though, up in Northern Michigan, we live very close to the Big Lake. It's not looking like this. It's looking a little bit more like this right now, but you can still get out. And I was just out with Buddy before we started to take a little walk in the snow. So joining us today, we have these absolutely fabulous folks. Again, I will, I'll do it now. I will. Loida is joining us today for the opening keynote. She is an international library consultant, researcher, and expert on topics such as human rights, advocacy, and services to multicultural populations. Also joining us today is Christian. I was very lucky to meet Christian for the first time after knowing of his work online this past summer in Copenhagen. He is based in Copenhagen and is director of libraries and citizen services. Oh, Christian, I'm sorry if I say this wrong, in Roskilde, Municipality, Denmark. I apologize for that.
No worries.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Stacey Ledden is going to join me for the closing keynote today. That will be in our last half an hour. She is with AnyThink Library. She is She is Director of Strategic Partnership at Anythink, and I will invite you to join us for that last half an hour. We're going to do some summations. We're going to talk about staffing and all the wonderful things that Anythink is doing. And finally, joining me now for this opening keynote is Rivkah Sass, and she serves as Library Director CEO of Sacramento Public Library Authority, California's fourth largest public library system, yay. And the first public library, and this is a big shout out because this is a big deal, they just received this award. They are the first public library in the United States to receive the Gerald M. Klein Community Impact Prize. So well done, well done. And we will hear from each of these fine folks very soon, but what I thought I would do is lay some groundwork for us, if you all don't mind, about why we happen to be here. So I'm going to cite from way back in the day, Patricia Palore, 1957, writing an essay for librarians. And she said, the best folks in libraries are those who find in their jobs, whatever they may be, the excitement and that reward she would because her library work. That I think time gets so today and like and all before we further y'all just take a breath in now. So glad we could come together like this. I appreciate all of you coming in from a region. It makes me very happy that we can meet in this global arena this way. But again, there is so much going on. I just want you all to, you know, just want to send out some good vibes to everyone, wherever you happen to be. So why are we looking at the beautiful sunrise on the coast of Eastern Australia? I was there a couple of summers ago and I was doing a big conference. And I was jet lagged and I found myself walking every morning at the crack of dawn. And I realized there were library folk around. And you do what you do when you're at a library conference is you start talking with people. And I chatted with a wonderful librarian. We walked a long way down the beach. And she said, yeah, I wanted to get out. I wanted to walk a little bit before, you know, all day in sessions, I'll be just sitting and I'll be engaged. And then she just wanted to be out and be moving. And as we parted, she said, take care of yourself. I said, well, yeah, and you take care of yourself. And that you take care of yourself too. And that really, really resonated with me because I was thinking so much then about what we do in libraries and what we need to do for ourselves so we can do what we do in libraries. And that is take care of ourselves. Because one of the things we do in libraries is we really take care of the folks that come into our buildings and come to see us virtually. Tending to the needs of users means offering a safe space for every person who comes through our doors to learn and grow. And again, I mean that in all possible senses of the word door. Designing welcoming spaces for folks to come together to collaborate and exchange ideas, and creating thriving digital communities and providing participatory services to promote learning and well-being. And one of the things I want to tap into today is that last thing, promoting learning and well-being, because really and truly, I think we need to take care of the whole person as best we can. And that might be reaching out for partnerships to help us take care of people. That might be establishing alliances that we haven't had before that brings people together to support them. Someone sent me this article just lately. The future is emotional. Human jobs in the future will be the ones that require emotional labor. And I really believe that's what we're talking about today. Okay, Christian, I have used this for many presentations. So here you are. This is even before I met Christian. And he tweeted, helped a woman this morning carry her baby carriage and kid, broken escalator, 40 steps down to the underground station. Helping others are so badass. Yes, it is. Also, that is why I love working with libraries so much. That, yes, because we are definitely in the people business. How are we doing that these days? We're doing that with the library kitchen or the culinary literacy program. We're doing that with meditation programs, and there's going to be a session during our conference today on meditation programs in the library that I'm very excited about. We're doing that through art installations where folks can take their photos and hashtag them and put them up on Instagram. We're doing that by encouraging members of the community, and in this case, the young people that are served by Townsville City Libraries in Queensland, Australia, to make the furniture their own by decorating it with designs and doodles and cool artwork. And then that becomes, they have ownership over that space in the library. And we do it, and I love this example, and a shout out to our friends at Capital Area Libraries in Lansing, Michigan. This is the community closet. You can help yourself to what you need, personal care type items inside of this space. Just let yourself in, let yourself back out, get what you need. And I love this as well. This is from Peter Musser. Today I waived $14.80 worth of fines because, dang it, kids deserve to not be afraid of going to the library. Absolutely. The other thing I want to pull into the mix from my point of view is the power of stories. We have a session later on today from colleagues of mine in Australia talking about this as well. I really think stories can take on so much power and can really help us learn about each other and about how we view the world. I think stories can take many different forms. It might be something as easy as putting up a board in the library and asking a question. Here's one from inspired by the work of Candy Chang. Before I die, I want to travel the world, accept myself. Wow, write what you want and put it on the wall. Absolutely, absolutely. It might be sharing stories that come in the amazing new, and it's not new, but the golden renaissance of podcasts. And here's an example of a library pairing podcasts with really cool books. So you might have your favorite podcast, My Favorite Murder, or Lore, or This American Life, and then books to go along with it. And we might be telling stories in new and different ways. I did a Wholehearted libraries session for Cedar Rapids Public Library, just to give them a little shout out a few months ago. And one of the things we did was we told stories in emoji form. And we wanted to do this as a way for the staff to understand that everybody does carry around their own story and it can help us understand them. And this is one of the library staff. This is totally anonymous, but this was her story of her daughter growing up, coming out, finding love, getting married, and moving to Colorado. And, you know, we put these on the big screen and people tried to, you know, figure them out. It was just so beautiful and so touching and so wonderful for this type of sharing. So you can actually tell stories via emoji as well as something much more formal like the New York Public Library Community Oral History Project. One more from our friends at Cedar Rapids. This is from their Instagram. This is a stay-at-home father of six kids, and he tells his story as to why he loves the library, and this just warms my heart. So I really believe that the dialogue that stories can create benefits all who participate. Everyone can contribute. So how do we do this? Just very quickly, and I'm very anxious to hear from our panelists. How do we do this? Well, for sure, we can take an example from our friends in Denmark at the Dock One Library. They built their new building, their beautiful award-winning building, for people and not books, creating a space for all. We can take a lot away from Eric Kleinenberg, who said social infrastructure is a set of physical places and organizations that shape our interaction and turns community, and he includes libraries in this, from a vague, fuzzy concept into a lived experience. So I'm now gonna bring it back to us. We are learners, and that's one of the reasons you all are here today. We make connections and we open doors. And I kid you not, I kid you not. It starts with us. So again, thank you for being here. I hope you are challenged. I hope you are excited. I hope you find some really cool things to think about as we explore what it means to be in the ultimate service profession. Peter Bromberg, who's director of Salt Lake City Public Library, sent this to me. This is a sign on the door of one of the departments. We work together to make life better. That's what we do, folks. We are inclusive, open, curious, playful, and kind. Absolutely. And you know what those are? Those are soft skills. And I would argue, hold that thought. Okay, here's what I did. I did a couple of things. I did that thing, students, if you're watching, don't open your paper with this. According to the dictionary, comma, soft skills is defined as blah, blah, blah. But don't do that. But I'm going to do it here for you today. This is from the Oxford Dictionary. Soft skills are personal attributes that enable someone to interact effectively and harmoniously with other people. I did some thinking, I did some searching and looking. Other things to describe soft skills, emotional abilities and interpersonal skills. They travel with you from job to job. They are intangible, but important, and they are difficult to teach. This is my take. I think soft skills are hard skills, and that's why I was honored when Steve and Sandy asked me to put this session together and to bring us all together around these ideas. These might be curiosity, creativity, having confidence, empathy, character, being of sound character, having compassion, demonstrating mercy. And this was shared with me from a librarian who's going to do the presentation on meditation. His name is Jeremy. In just a bit. And he really got me thinking about that word and what that means for the work we do, and understanding. So very quickly, I honestly believe we are the heart of our communities. And again, this is the it starts with us bit. And that only works because of all of us and what we give of ourselves. We make an emotional investment because we believe in the institutions and the communities that we serve. So I want to turn it over to our keynote panel. I appreciate your patience with me today while I talked about all this stuff because it just fires me up. And I'm really interested to hear from these folks. What does it mean to be a wholehearted library? And Rivkah, I'd like to ask you to start, please. And I'm going to go through your slides. So just give me the little slide, please. And I will gladly do that for you.
So Rivkah came in by phone, but she's not able to figure out how to unmute herself. So we're working on that. Can you skip to the next one?
We can absolutely do that. We will stand by for just 1 second. Stand by. Christian. Hello, same for you. If you just tell me when to switch slides.
Perfect, Michael. Thank you. And thank you all for having me. My name is Christian. Hope you can all hear me loud and clear. I'm calling in from Copenhagen, Denmark. It's around 8:30 here. So family is in the other room and I'm, you know, in our bedroom. And it's the first time I ever did a talk from my bed, but it's kind of resonating with the theme. It is quite comfortable. So thank you for inviting me on board to do this talk to you all about this great and very important topic. To me, libraries are very much about people, and I think it's important to remember that libraries are not a goal in themselves. They are meant to create stronger communities, to change people's lives to the better. And on this first slide, you see what I find to be the two most important assets of any library. That would be the members of the community and the library staff. So to understand libraries and to understand communities, you need to understand people. We also need to understand collections. We need to understand different kind of medias, knowledge organization, information retrieval. But cutting to the bone, libraries are a people business and not a book business. You could say people are quite complex creatures, but on a basic level, really, we are not that complex. Michael, you wonderful man, could you change to the next slide? So I would like to suggest you all that you just go and listen to the amazing song, How Soon Is Now, by the Smiths, where Morrissey sings, I am human and I need to be loved just like anybody else does. To me, that really puts it to the mark. And I think that is basically what most people strive for in life. I would worry deeply about you if you told me that you don't need love and others to care for you and you to care for others. Now, I guess that a great 80s songs might not be a bit too easy to one with. So one could also turn to psychologist Abraham Maslow and his hierarchy of needs. Now, Maslow suggests that humans are driven and motivated by different steps of needs in life. The first in physiological, we need food, we need water, we need rest to function as human beings. The next one is safety. It could be safety for our lives, our health, or also financial safety. And the next one is really, really significant. We need love and we need belonging. We need family, we need friends, we need lovers. We need to sense that we are connected to something greater than ourselves. Many people become susceptible to loneliness, social anxiety, clinical depressions, the absence of love and belonging. And the need to belong may overcome the psychological and security needs depending on the strength of the peer pressure. So I think this is really vital to understand when working with people. And turning towards libraries supporting stronger communities, I think it is important to ask the right question. And to me, the question is, to which challenge is the community in the community is the library the answer? Obviously, those challenges varies from community to community. The struggles we have in Roskilde might not be the same as in Mexico City, but I also find that in this world we are living in right now, there are some definitive challenges that you more or less find in any place of the world. Those could be inequality when it comes to gender, race, economic status, education, religion. It is loneliness, polarization, and social exclusion. You might draw a straight line from those challenges to the Maslow's hierarchy of needs and the need to love and to belong to something. I find libraries to be very strong answers to those challenges of inequality, loneliness, polarization, and social exclusion. Libraries to me are forces of social good. We are open, inclusive places. We are forces of cultural activity and lifelong learning. Libraries are one of the last and single institutions in society where you can come and be a part of the community without anyone demanding anything from you and without you have to take money out of your pocket. I think that is really, really important to many people. Libraries are where the punk and the senior citizens reach for the same book and acknowledge that the library staff is the most important asset of the library. It takes more than just being a professional librarian, being skilled at knowledge organization and information seeking to face those challenges, and actually to work with them. It demands library workers to care about other people that are interested in other people. It takes library workers that trust other people, that are curious about other people. It takes library workers that puts an interest in knowing what's going on in the community. And it is utterly important that we acknowledge those soft skills and work strategically with them in our libraries. Most of us can learn proper information seeking, but not everybody can learn to trust and to care about other people. On this final picture, you see Christine. She is a librarian at Roskilde Libraries, and she is handing over a home-knitted scarf to a homeless shelter in Roskilde. The scarf has been knitted in our library cafe at Roskilde Library by community members, and we do this on a regular basis. To me, this is an act of a wholehearted library. I guess this was my 5 minutes take on this important topic. So thank you for listening all.
Okay, Steve, let's check in. How is Rivkah? Is she connected?
Well, let's see if she responds. If not, we're still working on it.
Oh yeah, that's fine.
I think maybe not.
Okay. Well, we will, Loida. Welcome, Loida. Thank you.
Hola. Hello, everyone.
Oops. Sorry.
I just today I want to talk about serving with love. And I'm a big believer in conversations about how we must serve with love, embedding equity, diversity, and inclusion, also known as EDI. So embedding that in all what we do. My dream remains to create community spaces that reflect equality and respect among people. We have come a long way, our profession, but more conversations and more importantly, actions are needed. Next slide. While hate, authoritarianism, and open oppression are seemingly on the rise worldwide, I am heartened as I travel to communities across the world and see light, hope, and commitment in each one of our library workers who are continually empowering one and another. And I know we are ready to deepen the difference we make in our communities. Next slide. I wholeheartedly believe that librarians are enriching the conversation around these topics. And I am aware that it is not an easy task. Therefore, we must be intentional in our thinking and our actions to serve as a catalyst for this change, to move the needle in this area. Next, as a Caribbean woman with Spanish, Greek, African, and Taino blood, I am connected to vulnerable groups. I share many of their experiences, and I know about inequality, struggles, racism, and aggressions. In my own professional practice, I am intentional about the work required to counter negative forces that impact our library services. Next. One of my focus areas during my presidential year was to address the promise and challenges of providing diverse and equitable services within our communities and our libraries. Next slide. Together with my advisory board and with the ALA staff, we developed a video series to help library workers embed EDI, equity, diversity, and inclusion, in their academic, public, and school libraries. We center our videos around three questions that we peer reviewed with a number of librarians, experts on EDI. I believe these questions are key to build the foundation of services reflecting EDI, and I hope that each one of you can explore them more with your colleagues at your workplaces. So here are the questions. How does equity, diversity, and inclusion factor into your daily life as a librarian? What is the single biggest challenge facing libraries when it comes to EDI? And the last question, what are some effective ways that libraries can promote equality, diversity, and inclusion in our communities? And you are free to go to the ALA YouTube channel and just type EDI in our libraries. You should get the results are shown on the screen. Next slide. I want to encourage us all to continue to advocate for all people, especially those from vulnerable groups. And Michael, feel free to go on until slide 12. For instance, we need to continue advocating at our own library systems level, at our local, national, and federal government, and even global level. Additionally, and that's at the United Nations, and the next one is at the European Union. We have to go to those places. Additionally, we definitely need to be on the media speaking about how libraries are striving to provide access to information to all at our academic, public, and school libraries. We're serving with love and we're advocating. Next slide. That's the media piece. And the next. Okay, so I agree with Michael on connecting one's work to one's heart. I see these as the concept where our library programs and services should be intrinsically related to and reflect human rights, where we bring empathy, humanism, compassion, understanding, and reflective action to design these services. That is at the core of how I see how we serve with love. Next. We ought to do right by individuals that trust the library in such a way that they walk through the doors to access information that will save their lives, save our planet, and help us to continue building the world that we deserve. In the last slide, because we can, yes, we can.
Nice. Loida, thank you so much. All right. Okay, so what we will do is we're going to get some questions from the audience, but I wanted to ask the panelists while everyone is here some questions of my own, just so we can talk a bit further about soft skills, about some of the topics that we touched on. No worries at all. Okay. First question. This is coming from all of you that are working in the field. What does outreach and user engagement with libraries look like to you in 2020? And what soft skills are required for this new normal? What does outreach and user engagement look like in 2020?
Do you want to go first, Loida, or should I start?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. Well, to me, I think outreach and user engagement is, at least in Roskilde, very much away from the traditional library front desk. We still do a lot of very important work at our stationary front desk, but a lot of our relationships building and outreach to the community is actually outside the library buildings. It's bringing up community centers, engage community members for coffee and talks, and asking them what they want to do with us in order to make Roskilde a better place to live. And we do a lot of that. Sometimes it creates wonderful things, and sometimes it's just a cup of coffee, but that is still great too. And you shouldn't be sad about that. It's still another human being that you're meeting and that you're connecting with. And even though nothing concrete comes out of it, it's still valuable. Concerning soft skills, it takes a lot of, you know, relation skills. It takes that you actually want to engage with other people, that you are curious, that you want to move forward and not just, you know, hold on to status quo. It's really hard to go out in the community and do that kind of work if you don't care for other people and don't want to engage with them. So basically, it really takes, you know, people, persons to do that kind of work.
Okay, Christian, I really appreciate that you said that. Loida, I'm going to say two words here. Coming from my point of view as teaching soon-to-be librarians, we start in the core classes now with, this is a people-oriented field. We are studying community. We are studying how people use and exchange information in the context of community, because we need people that are graduates that are, as Christian said, people or people persons. I think that time, I'm going to be a little stereotypical, please don't get mad at me, that time of thinking you can go into librarianship and be surrounded by dusty books and not have to face outward very much has passed. It does seem so much that we are in the helping people business. Loida, thank you.
Yes. Well, in my book, to do this type of activity, outreach, and looking into the soft skills, I looked into kindness, into being interested in the world, having these communication skills, being more popular, having a flexible attitude, and that's not only for certain types of libraries. I always mention communities at academic, public, and school libraries. And also showing a degree of social intelligence where we take care and take time of knowing ourselves and also knowing others. Knowing others or knowing the communities that we are serving at these different library types. There is something I always mention, and I'm so glad that Christian mentioned it. I've done posters, I've done conference presentations on what's in it for me in terms of the public, right, the library users. And it has to do, I always linked it to Maslow, and I'm glad that Christian mentioned it, because we have this information and we know it can save lives and the planet and everything, but there is a piece in it, what's in it for the users that are hungry or don't have a roof or, are sick. And so that's where the outreach that we do has to be very carefully planned. And so that's why I mentioned kindness and communication and curiosity and interest and social intelligence, because we do need to, this is a job, yes, but we do need to put in practice some of, understanding us and understanding the other, so we can actually provide information that is useful for them, for their basic needs, as it was mentioned, and also to save their life and the planet and everything else.
I just caught in the chat, there's so much wonderful stuff going by, but Vanessa said, this is a wonderful quote that really taps into what you both have said. Be kind, I just wrote it down very quickly. Be kind because everyone is fighting their own little battle. I really believe that. And Loida, what you said about understanding other people, I think that should be one of the things that we look for in folks that want to work in libraries, is that curiosity about people's lives and about kind of understanding, the world beyond their own frame of reference. And if you can tap into that curiosity of folks, that goes much farther than any of the hard skills that we might be able to teach them in library school. And so, Steve, how are we doing? Should we check in with Rivkah, or should I go on to the next question?
Rivkah, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I can see you all, and it's so frustrating. Oh, brother. Hi, okay. Everybody.
I'm going to go to your slides,
Rivkah. Thanks for your patience. Great. Thank you all for your patience. I'm actually in Amman, Jordan. This is my week to volunteer at Zaatari Camp, which is home to 80,000 Syrian refugees on the Syrian border. And everything you're talking about is what we're talking about this week at camp, including, I saw somebody talk about budgets. I've been going around with a colleague interviewing the volunteer librarians. And guess what they all want? More books, more training, more interaction, more ways to connect with their public, and how to make their libraries better. So what that tells me is we've got wholehearted librarians everywhere in the world, even in places like Zaatari Camp, which is a great wake-up call for all of us. I'm sorry if I'm going to be a little disjointed, only because you know what happens when you're hoping that you're going to get on and everything works. I I tested Zoom several times over the week and everything worked fine. And then of course, here I am. So could you advance the slide? I'm not sure I'm able to do that, Michael. So I want to talk a little bit about the fact that as a librarian with 40 years experience, 30 of the 40 years I've worked as a librarian, I'm really old, have been spent working in public libraries. So that's sort of my unique perspective. The slide that you're looking at right here is, it's our all staff day for Sacramento Public Library. So what you're seeing is about 90% of our staff, all of whom gathered together for a half day of EDI work and a half day of strategic planning, talking about what are our values as a system? How do we need to change them? How does looking through an EDI lens change who we are? And what does it do for us? It was a great day. It's also a day when I wanted a picture of the entire staff because I knew, but not very many other people knew, that we had just won the Jerry Klein Community Impact Prize, which was featured in Library Journal back in November. And I wanted to make sure that anybody who read the article knew that the reason we won that prize was right here in that room. It's all the staff and their commitment. It's what they do every single day. It's how they serve. It's how they're devoted, how they're enthusiastic. And you know, the other piece of being wholehearted from my perspective is that it really means it's the courage to make mistakes and be vulnerable. And it's something that we try to practice every single day, I hope, at Sacramento Public Library. It's easier for some of us who don't mind failing than it is for others. But anyway, that's why we're all there. You know, when it comes down to it, I think right now I'm 6,000 or 7,000 miles away from home, trying to stay in touch with my colleagues, trying to make sure that we're responding to our community to help them know that our libraries are as safe as we can make them, that we're taking care with COVID-19, and that we don't want them to stop using us except if they're concerned for their own safety. For me, being wholehearted also means listening. It's listening to the community. Would you advance the slide, Michael? It's about being committed to what you're doing. It's about listening to the community. We use the Harwood community conversation method for that. We've had so far in the last year about 83 conversations with our community. And what did we learn? They want to feel connected. They want to feel safe. They want to they want to trust in their civic institutions. And it's our goal at Sacramento Public Library to make sure that they trust the library. And we serve that role in so many ways. And I wish I had time to tell you about all of the ways, but it's, let's put it this way. I never get tired of talking about what we do at Sacramento Public Library. Being wholehearted for me also means that we listen to staff. Often they have the very best ideas for what we need to do for library services. The people who work the front desk every day are the ones who see the pain when somebody can't pay a fine, and helping us convince our elected officials, who are our board, not a citizen board. So it's a little more difficult, but they're the ones who provide the stories that help us make changes that we need to make as a library system. I would hope that one thing we can all do as librarians is to keep trying things, to fail, and to try more things. I'm a huge fan of secondments. Sacramento Public Library has a somewhat unusual governance structure. And so we have a lot of autonomy and a lot of independence. So one of the things that we often do is we'll put people on secondment to try new things. So we did that a couple of years ago with our digital inclusion librarian, Chris. He was doing work out in the community working with high-need schools. and we had him do a presentation for our board, and they got so excited that we ended up making a position. And he just, he spent a year organizing the community. We held a digital inclusion summit, and it,
hello, Rivkah, did we lose you?
Yes, she's dropped out of the participant list, at least the phone connection was.
Okay, and that, wow, this just speaks to, one, the global nature of what we're doing and how distributed we can be, and as any time with technology, we just roll with it, because that, and I saw somebody say this in the chat, and I 100% believe it, that we're all human here, and there's no, you know, technology and everything, it is totally cool. I don't know if, let's see, Rivkah had just, a couple more slides. We'll see if she does come back in. I'm going to go back down here. I'm watching the time as well. We're going to do a couple things here toward the end, but I want to throw another question out, maybe to Christian and Loida. I'll throw into the mix here something that Rivkah said too about being all in. One of the things that I teach in the classes I teach at the School of Information is reflective practice. And reflective practice means we approach our work with open-mindedness. We take responsibility for our actions and with a wholeheartedness. And again, that's that whole, that all in, like I am all in for this work that I am doing. So another question for you all, and then we should probably take a look and see, I've seen so much go by. Hopefully we can get a couple questions from the audience as well.
Hey, can you hear me again?
Oh yeah, Rivkah, you're back. Yeah, here, keep going. It's cool.
I'm back. I'm so sorry. And oh, everybody, can I admit my vulnerability? I set the timer so I would stop talking at the right time, and I hit the, I turned the phone off by mistake. I'm so, so sorry.
No,
Michael, if we could get toward, if we could get to the slide with the words on it.
Yes.
This is so awesome. I have to
it
tell
is.
You. It's amazing.
It is totally awesome.
It's
Thank
amazing.
You, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to be really fast. And again, I want to go back to admitting failure, admitting mistakes, keep trying, do secondments, try experiments. It's the thing that I believe in with my whole heart about what makes libraries wonderful and real. And when it comes down to it, I feel this so much every single day at Sacramento Public Library. What can you really impact? One single person can impact so many people. I love that somebody mentioned, assume that people are having a hard day and greet them. And it's whether you're, Marcella Turner calls them his daily readers. It's whether you're serving people who are unsheltered and living rough. If you know their names, greet them by name. You can impact that one person with a little bit of compassion. And the other thing I'm going to say is, I want for all of you, especially those of you who are not yet fully in the profession, if you're not happy, find something else, because we're going to live a long time. We're going to work for a very long time. And I get up every day and feel so much joy. I'm exhausted. I haven't slept more than 4 hours a night in a week because I'm in a time zone that's now 9 hours different from California. And I wake up and I can't wait to get to camp. It's an hour and a half to get to that refugee camp. And I love everything I'm doing there. And when I get back to Sacramento next week, I'll feel the same way. Serve in your profession with joy, because it's not worth it. It's not worth feeling anything else from my perspective. And I am a fan of I'm a fan of the courage that Winston Churchill showed during World War II, how he kept people together, how he persevered in very trying circumstances. And one of the quotes that that I was just at the Churchill Museum a few months ago. It's been on my bucket list. And he said, "We are all worms, but I believe I'm a glowworm." I think it's incumbent upon all of us to be glowworms. Let's try to make the world a better place. Let's try to make libraries that pivotal point in our community. Go ahead, Michael, and quickly move the slides forward, and then I'll shut up. I just want to talk about a couple of things that we do, and that is we just served all 28 library locations. Can you get the slide forward, or it seems to be stuck. Anyway, we serve as every single library in Sacramento accepts ballots during the election for the month before the election. We have 10 voter service centers. Another example of being all in is what we do with Career Online High School. This is the 2019 graduating class. The woman in front is our community engagement manager, Kathy Crossway. And, but it's looking at your community, it's listening to them, and it's finding out what they need and then trying to address that need with what we are as libraries. And if you want to know more about Sacramento, please, just call us, do the next slide, and email me, rsass@saclibrary.org. Come visit us. We'd love to see you. We're hosting Neil Gaiman in May. We're thrilled for the Arbuthnot Lecture, and we invite you all to join us in Sacramento for what we hope is going to be a great time. But don't be afraid. Love what you do. Thank you.
Rivkah, thank you so much. Thank you. It's so nice. I'm so glad you got to finish your thoughts. Thank you. Okay, I am watching the time, folks. I want to do just two very quick questions from the audience, and then I want to wrap up just a little bit and send you on your way to all the sessions. Christian, this one is specifically to you. Could you please repeat the four challenges that you mentioned, the challenges that libraries answer in their communities? I got the first two, inequality and loneliness. What were the other two?
Polarization in society in general, you know, the gap between, you know, different parties is just getting bigger, and we're finding a really hard time to meet each other. At least to my attention, and then social exclusion.
Cool. And that, and I recall your slide said that sense of belonging as well. And that's what we want to aim for and provide space and support for folks
to
belong.
Yeah, totally. To me, belonging is one of the most powerful feelings in the world. And it's underestimated and not talked much about, I think. But you know, every morning I walk into our library in Roskilde, and on my right side, I see the library cafe, and it's the part of the library that gets filled the first. And I see a lot of men sitting there with a newspaper and a cup of coffee. They are, many of them is above 50, above 60, sitting there and being a part of community. They're not outside the community, they're not homeless people. They are, my guess is that they are maybe out of job, a bit lonely, divorced, something like that, and just sitting there, and I'm sensing that they are feeling that they're belonging, sitting there, being a part of community instead of sitting at home. So to me, it's just, you know, really part of you know, people lives in general, and I think libraries as places, as people, and as institutions has a great role in that sense of belonging to communities.
Cool. Thank you. Loida, here's a question for you. How should we approach our communities to help them understand the role of librarians is so much more than just helping them find resources.
Yes, I will say we need to get out from behind the reference desk and then go meet community organizations and community gatekeepers. And so we have them in our communities, in academic, public, school libraries. I will speak about public libraries because I am, lately I was a more public librarian. So I will connect with different groups, the Afghan Women's Group, the Columbia Civic Center, you name it, the LGBTQI teams group from the community. And so we need to connect with them. My technique is always more informal and to find out what they really need, you know, following this outwards approach. And for that, we need to perhaps do this during evenings or weekends or Sunday mornings when they're playing soccer. And so there are a number of things that we need to keep in mind. Engaging the community, looking for those organizations that are outside the library, looking for the gatekeepers, and then flexibility, right? We need to kind of like be okay with perhaps working different hours. And so that goes for the librarians, outreach and frontline staff, but also for administrations. How can we find the perfect balance, right? So we can do the job that we need to do to engage community and not only, you know, the library users, but the non-users. Those are the ones we're trying to reach. And so, yes, I will leave you with that.
Wonderful. So cool. Wow. We are hitting the end of our time. I just want to say a couple of words here. Next up, everyone, there are multiple sessions for you to attend and to continue your learning. We will, in 90 minutes, I will be back here with Stacy Ledden for the closing keynote. I'm going to ask you all to do this, to share this, Twitter or Facebook or email it to me, however you want to do it. This is a 3-2-1. Are you ready? 3 ahas that amazed you that you have heard during our time together today and in the sessions forthcoming. 2 concepts that you want to focus on, and 1 idea you want to apply immediately. And I need to cite who turned me on to the 3-2-1. It's a wonderful librarian at ALA a couple years ago. I will track down her name and make sure I say it in the closing keynote. 3-2-1, share it with me, put it on the Twitter, use our hashtags, if you will. Again, please take care of yourselves. That's one of the best things we can do. Open your mind, open your heart. And I've done a couple podcasts lately about wholehearted librarianship. And one of the folks asked me for a song lyric that really sums up what I think about librarians. And I will name check Fleetwood Mac here and the song Sarah. All I ever wanted was to know that you were dreaming. So thank you, everybody. Thank you to Rivkah, to Loida, and to Christian for sharing their time and for diving into this fun and inspiring and chaotic and human time that we've had together. I so appreciate it. Thank you, everybody, and I will see you in about 90 minutes. Take care. Thank you to all of you.
Awesome.
Yay.
Everyone.
Thank you all. Take care.